Hello everyone, good morning, good afternoon, good evening, depending upon when you are watching this video lecture. In the earlier session, we discussed about the scope of this subject, economics for finance, its importance, as well as syllabus when it comes to paper 8 of CA Intermediate. And as you are aware, this economics for finance contributes to 40 marks of paper 8. Now let's enter into the subject of economics for finance, starting with chapter 1, which is related to determination of national income. This chapter has two units. First unit focuses mostly on the computational aspects or measurement of national income, that too particularly in Indian context, whereas second unit will focus on the Keynesian theories related to determination of national income, which are universal, proposed by one of the most famous economists, Keynes. Before going to unit 2, let us start with unit 1 of chapter 1, that is determination of national income, particularly the measurement of national income. How does that happen? And this unit has broadly the following items contained in it: national income accounting. We don't think we are going to do some debit credit or something like that, not in that sense. Yes, definitely inclusions and exclusions will be there, measurement we can say than accounting, though the word used is measurement or accounting, but definitely accounting, national income accounting is a bigger word. In that, measurement is only one part of it. But anyway, ultimately, what is our objective finally that we are going to achieve at the end of this chapter and unit is, we will be able to measure the national income from the data that is given to us. But in order to do that, definitely we need to know different concepts of national income. And after knowing the concepts of national income, we should be able to measure the national income. And what are the limitations and challenges of national income computation also, we will try to understand in this particular unit 1 of chapter 1. So broadly speaking, these are the objectives or learning objectives of this unit, we can say. One is understanding various concepts, and second thing is understanding how to do the measurement of national income, and third thing is understanding various limitations or challenges which practically will be faced while computing the national income. That will be naturally the theoretical aspect of national income computation and its challenges. In a nutshell, chapter 1, unit 1 has these things in store. Now let us start with understanding some of the concepts of national income first. For that, first of all, we should know what is national income. And by the way, these all can be the questions also. What is national income generally, if it is asked as a question? And as we already discussed in our introductory session, questions from this paper, 40 marks of paper 8, will be either 2 marks or 3 marks, maximum 5 marks. And usually the 5 marks questions are related to certain computations. So the theory question, something like what is national income, if it is asked, it was asked, it will be for a maximum 2 marks or 3 marks. There will not be huge difference between what you write for a 3 marks question or 2 marks question, practically speaking. So the answer will be more or less the same, but you don't have to write or fill the pages heavily. You just have to write the essence of it. And that's what we are going to touch. That's what we are going to discuss. And you are supposed to note them and then remember them so that you can recollect them in the examination and write if such a question is asked. So like this, many such questions will be possible to be asked in the examinations. But the learning process itself can be in such a way where we have questions and answers to ourselves. And in the process of answering the questions and questioning the answers, we will learn what is economics for finance. And it will continue in the similar fashion for the upcoming sessions also. But the point here is, every time I don't have to tell, these are all possible examination questions. These are always possible examination questions. Any topic that we are discussing could be a question in the examination. There is nothing like some are more important and some are not or less important. Every topic already is summarized and presented to you so that you can straight away take them as questions and answers and then use them as tools for your memorization as well as recollecting in the examination. So that has to be kept in mind throughout the learning process. Every time I don't have to remind that. But while learning, we will naturally focus on the subject. Automatically, that will be having examination approach and examination relevance also. That is automatic. That need not be specially mentioned every time. That's what I mean to say. So let us start with understanding the concepts of national income. First of all, naturally, the question comes, what is national income? National income is defined as the net value of all economic goods and services produced within the domestic territory of a country in an accounting year plus the net factor income from abroad. That's what generally the national income is defined as. Of course, by the end of this topic, we will understand it in quantitative terms also. But conceptually, what is the definition of it is, it is the net value, net it is, of what? Value of all the economic goods and services. So first of all, we should understand each of these words, which we will do. First, we should know what is net, then what is value, then what is economic goods and services? Will there be some non-economic goods and services also? Yes, quite possible. So we should know what is economic goods and services and what are not. Produced. Produced here is one point you always have to keep in mind. Though the word looks like it is related to goods, we have to also understand every time we cannot say produced or rendered like that. Goods are produced, services are rendered. That we should know. But when we use the word production in economics, always it includes not just goods, it also includes services automatically. Again, a special mention is not required every time. We have to infer that. Whenever we say production, we have to think, okay, that is production of not just goods, but also of services. So, the net value of all economic goods and services produced within the domestic territory of a country, for example, India. And what is the domestic territory of India? The land, the borders of India is the domestic territory. Whatever is manufactured or whatever is produced, goods or services, the net value of those things which have been produced during an accounting period in India, let us say, is what is national income. But that is not all. Plus net factor income from abroad. So not only the value of the goods and services, economic goods and services produced in the domestic territory of a country within an accounting year. In addition to that, we have to add also net factor income from abroad. Each of them has its own relevance. we will understand in the coming slides what is net, what is economic and non-economic goods and services, what is domestic territory, and what is net factor income from abroad. But all of them put together is what is called national income. Ultimate objective of this chapter, ultimately unit, this unit will be to measure, to be able to measure that national income subject to the availability of data that is given to us. Anyway, this is a conceptual definition, theoretical definition. We are going to observe this by applying it into quantitative computations also later. Then naturally the theory also becomes easier to remember and understand. But for now, to start with, what is national income is this. It is the net value of all economic goods and services produced within the domestic territory of a country in a particular year, plus the net factor income from abroad. That is national income. And according to our central statistical organization, that is in India, national income is the sum total of factor incomes generated by the normal residents of a country in the form of wages, rent, interest, and profit in an accounting year. That is another definition, but both will be ultimately giving the same. We'll come to that also. When you look at the first portion of the definition, which is a general definition throughout the world, when you say the net value of the economic goods and services produced, this is word used is produced. So here produced is the angle. So that is a kind of production related theory from which the national income can be computed. But not only that, it can be income related computation also, even according to Central Statistical Organization. So production approach is also there, income approach is also there. Of course, in fact, we'll observe that there is one more approach called expenditure approach. We'll come to that later. But from these definitions, clearly the first portion of the definition talks about production approach. Second portion of the definition, which was defined by Central Statistical Organization of India, says that national income is nothing but the sum total of factor incomes generated by the normal residents of a country in the form of wages, rent, interest, and profit in an accounting year. What does the people will earn ultimately? These are the only possibilities, no? Those who are working for somebody, they will earn wages. Those who have some property and allowed the others to use that property, they will earn rent. Those who have money with them and allowed an organization or other business to use that money, they will earn interest and profit also as a return to capital. So what are the factors of production if we generally observe? The factor incomes can be observed easily. What are the factors of production normally speaking? We say land in economics terms. Practically there are many words which are used as factors of production. Many different analogies are there, different terminologies are there. But in general, from economics point of view, what are factors of production? We say land, labor, capital, organization. That's all. These are the major factors of production. Modern definition of factors of production could be a little different. They say there are 5 M's for it, just for easy understanding. Men, machinery, money, methods, and materials. 5 M's is what they call as factors of production. That is okay. All those things are just for a general understanding. But the point is, when the people have some resources with them, they let the others use that resource, they get some income from it. That is the only way of getting income. What is that resource? For a laborer, what is that resource? His work itself is the resource. He himself is the resource. That he will offer himself and his services, his physical or mental work that he offers to the other organizations and earns some money. That we call wages. Whatever the name it called, it is called. But all the people who are working for others, getting a salary or wages or whatever, is one portion of the incomes that is generated by the normal residents of a country in a particular year. In addition to them, there will be some people who earn interest also, or rent also, and profit also in that particular accounting year. But all of that put together is what is national income. So that is the sum total of all the factor incomes generated by the normal residents in a country in a particular year in the form of wages, rent, interest, and profit. That's what basically national income is all about. However, the first portion of this definition was focusing on production aspect of national income. Second portion was focusing on income aspect of national income, but ultimately both are same. We'll come to that. In fact, there is a third angle also, that is expenditure angle. All the three different dimensions of national income ultimately will and should ideally, theoretically give same result. That's what is the national income basic definition, we can say. Then a question comes, why is this national income accounting important? Such a question can be asked also. What are the objectives of national income accounting? Or what is the significance of national income accounting? Why is it important? Any type of question can be asked in the exam. Of course, depending upon the number of marks, you have to write only few points. You don't have to write all the points, all the times. 2 marks, 3 marks questions, you can write lesser number of points. 5 marks question, you can write more points. Usually the theory questions will come for 2 or 3 marks. But for understanding and learning purposes, we will learn them, all of them, or at least most of them. But you have to remember at least some of them, so that if a question like that comes, you should be able to reproduce and recollect and write that in the examination. And as I said, I'm not going to repeat this every time. So just for initial, you can say getting used to type of situation, I'm telling you. But afterwards, you should understand automatically, but each of them is possibly a question. Will the question be exactly same? Definitely not. Question need not be exactly same. The essence of the question will be same. If the question says, what is the significance of national income accounting? And if some students say, oh, I don't know that, then I can't help it. Same, no? Answer is same. When we say why national income accounting is important, what is the significance of national income accounting, all the essence of the question is same. So that is why learning has to be conceptual, not mugging type of learning. Those people who mug up the questions and answers will end up in not being able to answer the questions they know also, because they don't know the question itself. They don't understand the question itself. So I'm not talking about them. I hope you should not be like that. Understand the concept of each question. And of course, understanding alone is not enough. Understanding is important in the learning process. But from the examination point of view, understanding is not just enough. It is important, but not enough. That has to be added with memory. You have to remember things, words and points. Then you should have the ability to recollect them and reproduce them in the examination also. Always this has to be kept in mind. But once again, every time we cannot think about exam in the learning process, that you should always have in the back of the minds while learning it. That is why you should make a note of these things on paper in your own handwriting, so that helps you like a revision material later for your examination preparation. Anyway, we are going to just continue with the subject now onwards. Your responsibility is to think from examination point of view also, automatically, simultaneously, because both are not different. First point, first here, why national income accounting is important? What is the importance of national income accounting? Various processes are there, various points are there. Why is it significant? Why is it important? What are the objectives of national income accounting? All of them can be given with same answer. First and foremost thing is, national income accounting will be useful for analyzing and evaluating the short-run performance of an economy. So performance analyzation performance analysis and evaluation can happen with national income accounting. That too for short run performance. Second point, for determining the pattern of demand for goods and services. When you know the components of the national income, where the demand for goods and services is increasing and where is it decreasing can be identified, and that patterns of demand for goods and services can be understood from the data that is available through national income accounting. Because in a particular year, what component of the national income has contributed more, we can understand that. What is the contribution of a particular type of goods or services or a sector, we can say, to the national, to the overall national income can be identified. For example, if the construction sector is having lot of contribution in a particular year's national income, that means okay, a lot of activity happened in that sector, we can understand. Similarly, different types of sectors, different types of goods and services will have their own demand. But at a broader level, at an economy level, at a country level, how is this pattern changing, or how is this pattern actually exhibiting itself, can be identified through national income accounting data. In the sense, national income accounting is there, means the data or information from this is there available. That helps us, that facilitates us in doing the following things. That facilitates us in analyzing and evaluating the short-term performance of an economy. That facilitates us in determining the pattern of demand for goods and services. And not only that, for facilitating the economic welfare measures, governments can use this data. And for understanding the sectorial trends and formulate the policies accordingly, same like earlier, sectorial trends can be identified and understood. And for macroeconomic modeling and analysis, macroeconomic, broad level, government level, understanding, analysis, macroeconomic modeling can be done with the availability of national income data. And for assessing possible inequalities in the income distribution among different categories of income earners. So for a economy, for a particular economy, there could be inequalities in the income distributions of different types of income earners. Different types of income earners are there. For example, as we have seen earlier, some people are earning wages and some people are earning rent. Some people are earning interest and some people are earning profits. How much percentage of the national income is there in the form of wages? How much is in the form of rent? How much in the form of interest? How much in the form of profit? That can be identified. For example, if percentage of contribution of wages through to the national income is lesser, that means the salaried class, the working class is having problems. It has lesser benefit from whatever the work it has done. On the other side, if the profits are increasing, interest is increasing, that indicates the capital is more, if capital is getting more return than the labor. Like that, that shows the trends, that shows the understanding of how the inequalities in the income distribution could be there in an economy when we compare different categories of income earners. For that analysis, national income accounting data is important. And naturally, for analyzing the macroeconomic aggregates, aggregates are always about the broad level, national level data. Those can be analyzed by using the national income accounting information. And for facilitating economic forecasting and to take or make some projections with the existing data, certain forecasting can be done related to future, not by you and me, by the experts naturally. And that will be used for making some projections, forecasting, projections, both are more or less the same. A lot of times you would have seen some organization like RBI projects that next quarter GDP growth rate will be so much. Sometimes State Bank of India will tell that, just for general understanding. Or sometimes the World Bank projections will come, IMF projections will come. Some international organizations like Credit Suisse has projected India's GDP for the next quarter is going to be this much only, or for the next fiscal fiscal is nothing but the year, next accounting year is going to be this much only. Like that, we keep on seeing these things in the newspaper. How do they do that? Are they going to just sit in a room and keep on looking into the roof, and finally they come out with some number? Okay, should we tell 2 or 3, 2.82, something like that? Some numbers randomly they throw it on to the people, whatever they get in their brain. No, they cannot do that. That is not what they do. Those will be experts, economists, who are sitting there in the evaluation of or forecasting of future trends related to, naturally, the economic aggregates. GDP growth rate is one of such economic aggregates. Like that, forecasting can be done. But how can you do a forecasting or a projection about future unless and until you know what happened already in the past? Future cannot be forecasted without understanding what happened already in the past or what is happening now. So for that purpose, existing data on the national income accounting will be useful for economic forecasting and to make good projections. So these are the various you can say the objectives that national income accounting achieves, and that will be useful in all these points. What are those? Just quickly once again, to analyze short-term performance of an economy, to determine the pattern of the demand for goods and services, to facilitate economic welfare measures, for understanding the sectorial trends, and also to formulate the strategies and policies accordingly, for macroeconomic modeling and analysis, and for understanding and analyzing the inequalities in the income distribution of different income earners, and for analyzing macroeconomic aggregates, also useful for economic forecasting and to make projections. That is why and that is how national income accounting is going to be very useful for particularly the governments and also the policy makers. And businesses naturally will have a close look on how the economy is performing. In general, the performance of an economy is measured through this national income aggregates. What are those? We definitely come to that. That is the objective of this chapter. Now, what is this system of national accounts, SNA? This is a question by itself, short note question. All of them are short note questions only. System of national accounts means what? Answer is this. It is an internationally agreed standard set of recommendations on how to compile the measures of economic activity. That is called a system of national accounts. So imagine when we look at different countries doing their own national income accounting in their own ways without following any standardized procedure, then the national incomes of one country and another country will not be comparable. Comparability becomes difficult. That is why it is always ideal to follow globally one system of national accounts. That's what is the standard set of recommendations on how to compile the measures of economic activity. How to compile them, how to measure them will be told by the system of national accounts, which most of the countries follow. And this SNA describes a clear, consistent and integrated set of macroeconomic concepts, definitions, classifications and accounting rules. All of them will be prescribed by SNA. What all the things will be prescribed? Macroeconomic, naturally, concepts, definitions, classifications and accounting rules also. So you cannot have different words in different countries. You interpret, one country interprets one word in one way and the same word is interpreted by another country in another way. That would not be correct. So there should be a standard set, integrated set of such macroeconomic concepts, definitions, classifications and accounting rules. That's what is SNA is all about. And who developed this SNA? This was developed by United Nations, UNO, that is United Nations Organization. And this provides naturally a comprehensive, these are all words, good words, but you have to just use them. Generally, stories if you write, you may not get good marks. You need to use these words. Comprehensive, conceptual and accounting framework for compiling and reporting the macroeconomic statistics for analyzing and evaluating the performance of an economy. So ultimately, what is the objective? Is to analyze and evaluate the performance of an economy. How do we analyze? How can we evaluate the performance of an economy? whether India has done better than China or China has done better than India in a particular year. How do we know that? When both the countries have published some macroeconomic statistics, then we can analyze. Then we can understand those numbers. Then analyze them. Then how to compute those statistics? If China uses a different method, India uses a different method completely without any commonality, then those two become not comparable. That is why United Nations organizations has suggested, it's a recommendation only, UN as an organization itself, you can understand, is a purely recommendatory type of organization. It cannot enforce a lot of things on the member countries, except in some cases of war and conflicts. That is a different story. But as far as these things are concerned, it is a recommendation of United Nations in the form of System of National Accounts, which provides a comprehensive conceptual and accounting framework for what? For compiling and reporting the macroeconomic statistics. How to compile the macroeconomic statistics and how to report them? What is the language that we should use? What is the methodology that we should use in compiling them, in collecting the data? And then finally, how to report those macroeconomic statistics? This methodology, this framework has been developed by United Nations in the form of System of National Accounts. And ultimately, what is the purpose of all this? Finally, to analyze and evaluate the performance of an economy. That's what is SNA, System of National Accounts. Then, as we just now discussed earlier, there are three dimensions of national income, not just one. Or you can say three concepts of national income. What are the concepts of national income? Broadly, three concepts are there. One is from the product side, as we discussed in the definition, that is from the product point of view. And as we already discussed, from the income point of view also, national income can be measured. But another point is also there, from the expenditure side also, national income can be measured and expressed. So what are the three dimensions of national income, if the question asks? Answer is product, expenditure, and income. Of course, we are going to discuss all the three of them in detail in the upcoming slides. But the nutshell of the three dimensions of national income is this: product angle, you can say perspective angle, or different dimensions of national income are these three. You can think about national income from a product point of view, production point of view, you can say expenditure point of view, or even income point of view also. Of course, whatever the point of view or whatever the methodology you apply, ultimately the final calculation of national income should be same ideally. In reality, will it be same or not? It is a different story. That depends upon the availability of data, availability of reliable data, which is very, very challenging in real life. For us, we don't have to worry. You and I are not going to publish any data. So all that we need to know is the concepts of measurement of national income from three different dimensions, namely product, expenditure, and income. What does the product side do? It measures the production based on the concept of value added. So this is a which angle? This is production angle. And what is the point of view here we have to remember and understand is, it takes the concept of value added during a particular period. Naturally, how much value has been added during a particular period by the country, that is production side of national income. Then second thing is expenditure side. Expenditure side looks at the final sales of goods and services, because sales of goods and services means somebody is buying, no? When they are buying, that whatever they are buying, that is expenditure. So first one is a production based concept. Name itself indicates, that is a product side. Expenditure means sales side concept, or purchases. Sales includes purchases, because both are two sides of the same coin. Purchase means expenditure. Of what? Purchase of what? All the people in the country, what is the total expenditure that they are spending for purchase of goods and services? That is expenditure side. We'll come to that also later. Then what is income side? This we have already observed. What is income side? That measures the distribution of the proceeds from the sales to different factors of production. So whatever the sale happened, some income is generated. How that income is distributed to different factors of production, that is looked at by the income side of national income. So when you look at the three dimensions of national income, and if you understand it from practical point of view, what happens in an economy, what happens in any society? Production happens first, that should happen, no? Okay, then fine, what happened after production? That production has to be sold. Yes, sales happened. Then what? Whatever the proceeds from that sales are there, they have to be distributed to different people. Who are those different people? Those are the factors of production, those who have provided their labor, those who have provided their capital or land or their intellectual property, whatever it is. So how this proceeds from the sales are distributed to different groups of people within the country, that is the income side. So broadly the three things are covered in the national income computation. Of course, all the three we cannot use, and we don't have to use every time. Whatever is asked, that only we have to use. But whichever the method is followed, ultimately the ideal situation is the final national income is same because the country is same. If you compute the national income from value-added method or production method, or if you computed national income using expenditure method, or if you computed national income using income method, ultimately the final outcome or answer should be ideally same. Ideally, not practically. Difficult. Why is that? We'll come to that later. But at this level, we should understand three dimensions of national income: production dimension, sales, and distribution. So production is common. Production has to happen of various goods and services. What is the value of all those goods and services produced in the accounting year? Yes, that is the production side of national income computation. Okay, these are all sold during that year. That is the expenditure side. And what are the proceeds from that sales are? Those are distributed to different people who have contributed to the production process in the form of being factors of production. That is the income side. All the three are different angles of national income. We can say the three different dimensions of national income, for that matter, three dimensions of an economy. All the three happens. All the three have to happen. Production has to happen. Whatever that has been produced has to be sold. And whatever that sale proceeds are, they have to be distributed among different people. All the three should happen. They keep on happening in an economy, in a country. And all the three will be having three different types of methodologies for computation of national income. That is the basic understanding on the three dimensions of an economy, or we can say three dimensions of national income as well. Now let us enter into the real computational and definition aspects of different terms while we compute national income. Finally, we reach national income at a much later stage. But what is the starting point here, particularly when we look at GDP, which is the most popular word that is used, and which angle we are looking at, that should be understood from the formula itself. Are we looking at production angle? Are we looking at expenditure angle? Or are we looking at income angle? That should be always observed. Normally, unless otherwise stated, we are looking from the production angle only. In other words, value added. Value added is the angle that we look at all these various economic aggregates, starting with GDP. GDP, MP. What is MP here is market prices. Gross domestic measure at market prices. That's what is GDP, MP all about. What is this GDP at market prices? It is the measure of market value. That is why we are calling it as MP, market prices. It is the market value of what? All final economic goods and services. Final is another word used. Means there might not be some goods which are final, that we have to look at. And economic goods, already as we discussed, is a different point. Some goods may be economic goods and services, some may not be. So we'll come to that. What is final? What is economic? What is gross? What is domestic? What is gross here? Gross means gross of depreciation, means before deducting depreciation. Before deducting depreciation, what is the market value of all the final economic goods and services, gross of depreciation we can say. That's what is called before deducting depreciation. Of course, naturally produced, that is why we are looking at from a production point of view. Within the domestic territory, that is why it is a domestic product. Gross is indicating it is gross of depreciation. Domestic is indicating domestic territory of a country. For example, India. Within India, whatever happened. Within India, whatever the value of the goods and services produced during an accounting year, during a particular year, or during a given time period, whatever it may be, quarter also, half year also, year also, that is what is GDP, that is the gross domestic product. Simply speaking, it is nothing but the sum total of the value added by all the producing units in the domestic territory and includes the value added by current production by foreign residents and foreign owned firms also within the domestic territory. This is the point to be noted very clearly. Between domestic and national, that is the difference. Domestic is the word used for the territory. What is the territory we are calling? Okay, let us call this territory is what we are calling it as India. Within this territory, whatever production happened, whatever the value of the goods or services that have been produced within the domestic territory of India, whether they are produced by local residents and citizens of India, whether they are produced by foreign residents and foreign owned firms within India also, they will be falling in gross domestic product. Now, for example, say Kia Motors has production in India. Just for example, like this, many multinationals, many international foreign companies have production in India. We all know that. Just for example, if you take Kia Motors has production in India and it has produced, let us say, in a particular year, 10,000 cars. Not necessarily all the cars are sold within India. Maybe it will export some of the cars from India to other countries also. That is not what we are looking at. Are we looking at sales side here? No, we are looking at value added side in this angle. In this angle, we are only looking at value added, means production actually happened. 10,000 cars Kia Motors has produced in India. So the value of all those cars, should it be added to GDP or not? Answer is yes. Why? Because it has produced within India, but is it an Indian company? No, it's a Korean company. Like that, many multinationals manufacture so many things within India, and we are also encouraging that. We are calling it as Make in India. Why Make in India? If even a foreign company, foreign residents and foreign owned firms will come to India, and if they produce certain things within India, that will be added to the GDP. While expressing it, gross domestic product means the word domestic indicates domestic territory. It does not indicate that is the value addition done by Indians. That is the point we have to understand. Indians is different. India is different. India is a domestic territory. And Indians is a nationality. So India domestic territory, within that, whether Indians or foreigners or Indian companies or foreign companies, whoever is there, all of them, whatever the value of the goods and services that they have produced during the period, that value is called as gross domestic product. And what value is that? Market value of what type of goods? Final goods and final economic goods. And should it be gross of depreciation or net of depreciation? It should be gross of depreciation. When we call it gross, it is gross of depreciation. Then where they are produced? Within the domestic territory of a country. In our example, India. During a given time period, that's what is GDP at market prices. Simply speaking, that is the value added by all the units in the domestic territory, including the value added by the current production of foreign residents or even foreign owned firms within the domestic territory. That's it. That is GDP at market prices. That can be expressed as a formula. That is nothing but the value of output in the domestic territory. What is the value of all the goods and services produced during the period in the domestic territory minus the value of intermediate consumption? That is where the point comes. Why this minus? Because we wanted the value of all final economic goods, final only, not intermediate consumption. If there are any goods which are produced but consumed in the production of some other goods, those are called intermediate consumption. Those are consumed in the production of final goods. Should they be valued also? Should they be included also? They should not be. That is why they are excluded here. Just for example, for understanding, we'll come to this anyway. There is a discussion on what are intermediate goods and what are final goods. But before going to that, just for general understanding, intermediate goods are those which are not final goods, which are used for the production of final goods. Those are called intermediate goods. The intermediate consumption like that shall be excluded from the value of output which has been measured for a particular period within the domestic territory. In other words, simply speaking, what is the value added during the accounting year, during the period, is what is called GDP at market prices. Value is here what value? Market value, at market prices. Sale value, saleable value, we can say. That is what is GDP at market prices. And while calculating it, very important point to note is, intermediate consumption has to be excluded. Only final economic goods and services have to be considered, and their market value has to be considered. Gross of depreciation, all these points have to be noted. And that too, the word domestic indicates that we are looking at domestic territory of a country, irrespective of whether the production happened from the locals or foreigners. That doesn't matter. If that happened within the domestic territory, that forms part of GDP. That's it. Now, certain points to be noted in GDP computation are to be very keenly observed. Some of them we already observed and identified. What does the term gross indicate? See, wherever we see, not only here, wherever we say this point G, let us say gross national product, gross domestic product, like that, wherever the word gross is used, that means it is measured gross of depreciation, that is before deducting depreciation. So that is the difference between gross and net. That can be understood now. What is the difference between gross and net? What is the difference? That is simply depreciation. Depreciation is the difference between gross and net as far as these expressions are concerned. Here, gross will be naturally higher than net, and gross minus depreciation will be net. But here we are looking at GDP, that is why it is using the word gross, means it is gross of depreciation. Then what is this word domestic talking about? Domestic is domestic territory or resident production units. Resident production units, not necessarily those are Indian. Those are not related to the same nationality. If Apple produces iPhones in India, Apple is not an Indian company, but if it produces its iPhones in India, then that becomes a resident production unit, and whatever the value of the phones or whatever devices it produces, that will be added to the GDP at their market prices. Now, another point to be noted, already as we identified, the value of only final goods and services are to be added, or only the value added by the production process would be included in GDP. So the value added is only added. That means final goods and services only, those value only should be added within this GDP. For example, in this example of Apple phones, let us say, Apple imports so many components from other countries, let us say, and just does the assembling process here. Let us say, if that's what it is doing, only the assembly of that mobile phone is happening here, and all the other components, software, everything that is importing from outside India. So should we take the market value of the Apple phone, or should we take only the value added in India to that phone? Answer is only value added. Value added in the production process should be only taken into consideration. Why? Because naturally, real addition to the value happened in India how much? To the extent of whatever the fresh effort that has been put on those phones production. So the point is here, only the final goods and services value has to be taken. From that, intermediate consumption has to be excluded. That is why the value of intermediate consumption has to be excluded. That means the final value of final goods and services only to be taken into consideration without taking the intermediate goods consumption value. In other words, excluding it from the final value. Then what is this value added? That represents the contribution of labor and capital to the production process. That is a simple point, conceptual point. What do you mean by value added? Who adds value? Labor and capital adds value. It's a different discussion whether capital adds value or not. When we look at the capitalist economy, which is the subject matter now, labor and capital adds value. So that contribution of labor and capital, whatever is there in the production process, that is called value added. Then what is intermediate consumption? That consists of the value of the goods and services consumed as inputs by a production process. So in a production process, let us say certain goods and services are consumed as inputs, they will be excluded. Because the final value is already calculated, and that value is market value, that you should understand. And that market value definitely includes already the value of all those goods and services which are inputted, which are consumed during this production process. For example, if you say sugar is produced in a particular year, the value of sugar, say some 40 lakhs tons of sugar is produced in India during 1 year. Let us say, example only. Multiply with what is the market value of sugar per ton. You get total value of the sugar that has been produced during that period. Very good. And should we also calculate the market value of sugarcane that has been produced during the year? Because sugar is manufactured by the sugar industry, the factory. Sugarcane is produced by farmers. Okay. Farmers produce sugarcane. That is a different sector altogether. And in that sector, farmers have produced, let us say, 1 crore tons of sugarcane or something like that during the previous year, during 1 year. So, should we add market value of sugarcane also in the GDP computation? That would be wrong, right? Because it amounts to duplication. When you look at the market value of the sugar, that already included the worth of or value of sugarcane in that. Without sugarcane, this sugar was not manufactured. So you cannot double account for the same thing. That is the reason, once again, always we have to keep in mind, when we look at the GDP at market prices, we have to take the value of the output, final goods, that is in the domestic territory, minus the value of intermediate consumption. Value of intermediate consumption has to be reduced from the value of final goods. That's it. Why is that? To avoid duplication, to avoid a double counting of same thing. That will show too much of GDP, which is not actually real. It is not the value added. So when you say sugar is manufactured, what is the value really added by the sugar industry? That only should be considered. How can we say that? Market value of the sugar minus the market value of all the intermediate consumption that happened in that production process will give us what is exactly the value added by that particular industry or factory. Like this, for the entire country, the intermediate consumption has to be excluded from the final value of goods and services. Then naturally this question remains, this can be an exam question also. What is the distinction between intermediate goods and final goods? It is not about CA intermediate and CA final, but yes, goods in this GDP and national income computations are classified into intermediate goods and final goods. What are intermediate goods? These are the goods which are used to produce the other goods rather than being sold to final purchasers. So sugar cane is not completely sold to the final purchasers. You may say some people have sugarcane juice, etc. Yeah, if that is the final purchaser, then that's okay. That's not an intermediate good. That will become a final good only. Intermediate good, it will become when if that sugarcane is used in the production of sugar, then sugarcane is intermediate good. Sugar is the final good. So what are intermediate goods? Simply, you cannot write only examples. Examples you can write, but you have to define them. For obtaining marks, you have to define the words exactly in the same way that has been given in the study material. Not necessarily sentences, but keywords have to be used and proper definition has to be given. Stories will not get marks. So what is intermediate goods? What is the definition of intermediate goods? Those are the goods which are used to produce other goods rather than being sold to the final purchasers. Those are called intermediate goods. They are not counted in GDP, as that would involve double counting naturally. For example, if you take another example, if we include the value of an automobile in GDP, car is manufactured, you included the value of the car. Should we also take the value of the tires separately, which are already used in the manufacturing of that car or bike? No, that will be double counting. No? So when you take the value of the car, market value of the car, finally, from that you should exclude the value of all the intermediate goods which have been used in that production process of that car or bike. So that is what intermediate goods are all about. They are not produced for selling them to the final purchasers. They are produced for being used for the production of other final goods. Those are intermediate goods. And the value of such intermediate goods has to be intermediate consumption or intermediate goods, you can call them, that has to be excluded. The value of intermediate consumption has to be excluded from the value of the final goods in order to compute GDP. And naturally, what are final goods? Those are the ones which are sold to final purchasers and meant for final consumption. Car is a final purchaser and final consumption. So that is a final good. Sugar is a final good. Sugar finally is going to be used. That becomes a final good. That is once again the point. Let us say sugar is used for giving or selling coffee by a coffee shop. Then will the sugar be the final consumption or final goods? No, the same sugar becomes intermediate good. The value of the coffee that is sold in that coffee shop will be the final good. Then the sugar becomes intermediate good. So when the final goods we are saying, that is the value of the goods which are finally sold to the final purchasers and meant for final consumption. We cannot go by the names. Is sugar intermediate good? How do we know? It could be intermediate good also. It could be a final good also. Is tires intermediate good? Could be. When if the tires are used for the manufacturing of cars or bikes, that is intermediate goods. Does it mean tires are not sold separately? They are sold separately also. Then that becomes final good. So you should not go by the examples and names. Examples are for understanding purposes. You should go by the concept of this. Intermediate goods are those which are not final goods, which are not intended, or finally they are not going to be sold to the final purchasers. Rather, those are going to be used in the manufacturing process of final goods. And naturally, the intermediate consumption has to be excluded from the market value of final goods in order to arrive at GDP. And final goods are those which are sold to the final purchasers and meant for final consumption. That is the examples. That is the concept of intermediate goods and final goods. Very important question. Many times such question was asked, and it can be asked also. Then we observed another point in the definition of GDP, where economic activities was the word used. Final economic goods and services. That was the word used, if you remember. Final, we understand now. Final means excluding the intermediate consumption. Now the question comes, what is economic activity and a non-economic activity? Simple point. Economic activity is something which is exchanged in the market. That is economic activity. Whichever is not exchanged in the market for a price, it is non-economic activity, simply speaking. So, what are economic activities? Those are the ones as distinguished from non-economic activities. Economic activities include all human activities which create goods and services that are exchanged in a market. Most important point for a particular activity to be an economic activity, that should be exchanged in a market and valued at market price. Naturally, when it is exchanged in a market, it will have the value at market price. That's what is economic activities. It will have a price. it will definitely have a price and it is exchanged in the market. Then such activity becomes an economic activity. What is a non-economic activity? Non-economic activities are those which produce goods and services. They also produce goods and services, but they are not exchanged in a market transaction. So naturally, they do not command any market value. There is no market price for them. What kind of activities? Non-economic activities. So when we compute GDP, what activities can only be taken? Economic activities or non-economic activities? Only economic activities. Non-economic activities value cannot be taken because they don't have a market value, because they are not exchanged in the market. But still, those are also there, which are good production of which is part of the production of goods and services. So non-economic activities are those, though they produce goods and services, they will not be exchanged in market, and hence they do not command any market value or price. For example, hobbies. Somebody wants to paint a picture. Excellent artist. They want to paint a picture. That's a hobby, let us say. Lot of time and effort is involved in that. And finally, some excellent painting also has emerged in that. Just because of that, that does not become an economic activity, though it resulted in the production of some goods or services. Why? Because it may not be sold in the market. On the contrary, if the same painting is sold in the market, let us say some exhibition is held and in that, if it is sold in the market, then it becomes, the same thing becomes economic activity. If it is sold, it is economic activity. If it is exchanged, sold is not a good word, that is why we are using the word exchanged in the market, that becomes an economic activity. And we have to remember some points in the basic economic aspects, like for every good or service, there will be use value and there will be exchange value. Every commodity or every good or service will have both of them in general. But use value is guaranteed. Some goods or services have use value, definitely. But if they do not have exchange value, then they are not called as economic goods. That means the activities which are incurred, which are actually undertaken for producing those goods, will not be called as economic activities. Because they don't have exchange value, they will still have some use value, may have some use value, but doesn't matter. Still, they do not have exchange value means those are the ones which are called non-economic goods. And activities which are involved in producing such non-economic goods are non-economic activities. For example, at home, housekeeping and child rearing services of homemakers. Our mothers, our fathers take care of us at home. And they cook for us, let us say. You know, they give some food to us. And they clean the house. They clean our clothes. Lot of services they do. Let us say if these are all done by a homemaker at home, whoever that may be. Then is that an economic activity? It is not. Because these are only given as services of family members and are done out of love and affection, not for any money. But at the same time, imagine the similar services are rendered by a maid, a servant. Then the same thing becomes economic activity. If, for example, our mother irons the clothes, that is not an economic activity. But if the same clothes are given to laundry and then that laundry irons the clothes in exchange of money, that becomes an economic activity. So any activity by itself, we cannot say whether it is economic or non-economic. Simple litmus test is whether it is exchanged in the market or not. Is it valued at a price or not? If yes, it is economic activity. If no, it is a non-economic activity. That classification is important. And while computing GDP, we cannot include the non-economic activities value. Does it mean people are not working? How many number of lakhs of hours? So many people at home who are homemakers, housewives, whatever we call, how much work and hard work they are doing in a year, if you observe, if you can really value that, though we cannot value that, but if you really can value that, that itself amounts to enormous amount of value. But do we do that? We don't. We don't value them because they are not exchanged. If they are purchased or exchanged and sold in the market, then they become economic activities. So simple point, if you go and buy some food in a restaurant, that becomes an economic activity. If your mother or somebody, father or somebody makes a food at home and just consumes that within the house, that is not an economic activity, because that is done only out of love and affection. That's it. So exchange is the important point here. Use is something which every goods or services will generally have. So the point here to note is, while computing the GDP, while determining the national income, while measuring the GDP, should we include non-economic activities? Answer is no. We should include only economic activities which can be exchanged in the market for a price. And that too, final goods only, excluding the value of intermediate goods. And that's what is shown in this formula. The value of output within the domestic territory minus the value of intermediate consumption is GDP at market prices. Okay. So these are the various aspects of GDP and different points within that. What are intermediate goods, what are final goods, and what are economic goods and what are non-economic goods. Economic activities, non-economic activities. Then another short question can definitely be asked. What is a production boundary? It's not that there is a physical boundary where we can observe that tangibly. No. But yes, since GDP is a measure of production activity, it covers all the production activities recognized by the system of national accounts, called as production boundary. That's what SNA has classified as production boundary. So what activities are all within the production boundary? Those all will be added up in order to compute GDP. So simply, the production boundary covers the production of almost all goods and services classified in National Industrial Classification. That is another terminology related to SNA, that is the system of national accounts. They have a classification done called as National Industrial Classification, that is covering almost all the types of goods and services which are forming part of the production boundary. What are the things which are included also here? Also included, production of agriculture, forestry, and fishing, which are used for own consumption of producers, also included in the production boundary. So that can be a case-based question, a small point, whether this should be included or not. Answer is yes. Own consumption only. Actually, those are not exchanged, but still, those are included. Which ones? Agriculture, forestry, and fishing, used for own consumption of the producers, also included in the production boundary, according to SNA. That is what is production boundary. All types of goods and services are included here within the production boundary according to SNA, the system of national accounts. That is production boundary. Are these the only things which are included in GDP? There are some other things also which are included. That is another point to be noted, very important point also. Because from now, so far, as of now, what we have observed is value of final goods only will be included. We know that. Intermediate consumption will be excluded. We know that. Now, naturally, a question comes, sir, what about capital goods? Should they be included or not in the GDP? Answer is yes, they should be included. And what about the inventory investment? Inventory investment means which is not actually sold but produced, which is there in the stocks and godowns. Should that be included or not? Answer is once again yes. So these are the two things which should also be included in GDP, though they are not actually directly mentioned by the definition. Definition only says, oh, more value of all the final goods and services produced within the domestic territory of a country in a particular period. That's all. But while understanding the measurement of GDP, we should also keep in mind there are two things which whose value also should be included. One is capital goods, second one is inventory investment. Those are the things to be included also. Capital goods means what? Naturally, plant equipment etc. Those are capital goods. Inventory investment means what? Inventory investment is basically the net change in the inventories of either final goods or materials. And this inventory investment net change could be positive also, negative also naturally. And these additions to the inventory stocks of whether final goods or materials belong to the GDP because they are currently produced output. The main point is that they are not sold, they are not yet consumed, but still are they produced or not? Yes. That addition happened means production happened, right? Let us say opening stock of final goods and materials is there. Let us say for all the companies and all the organizations put together, you have to come out of one company, one organization accounting mindset. We are looking at the country as a whole. In the entire country, opening stocks were all like, let us say, 1.5 lakhs crores of rupees of opening stocks are there. And at the end of the year, 1.6 lakhs crores rupees worth of closing stock is there of finished goods as well as the materials. That means what? Additional net change in the inventories, how much happened? Let us say 10,000 crores of rupees of investment additionally happened during the year. Is it not produced during the year? Yes, it is. But is it sold or consumed? No, not yet. Does it mean we will not include in GDP? No, that is wrong. It should be included in GDP because that is also representing currently produced output only. So inventory definitely should be included. Additional investment in the inventory has to be included. Of course, if that figure is minus, then it will be minus. Plus or minus, it could be positive also, negative also. That is inventory investment, one part of it. Capital goods is another scenario, which is a tricky scenario. They should be also included. Can we consider capital goods as intermediate goods? That is a problem. Let us take another example. Let us say tractor is purchased by a farmer. Is the tractor a final good or an intermediate good here? Question comes. And definitely people are not going to buy a tractor. Tractor is used in the production process of agricultural produce, which the people will buy later. So is the tractor an intermediate good? Can we say that? Answer is no. That is a capital good. So when we said intermediate goods, those are not capital goods. Capital goods should not be excluded. They should be included. If so many tractors are sold in a particular year, you cannot say those are all intermediate goods and I will exclude the value of them from GDP. Those are used by the farmers. We know that. Ultimate final consumers are not going to use the tractors. Those are used in the production process as equipment, as plant, as machinery. Those capital goods have to be included in the computation of GDP. Those should not be considered as intermediate consumption. That is wrong. Intermediate consumption is different. Capital goods are not consumed. They are used. That differentiation has to be kept in mind. So capital goods are not intermediate goods. They should not be excluded in the computation of GDP. Neither the depreciation on them should be excluded because we know already GDP we are talking. Gross means gross of depreciation without deducting depreciation. So capital goods value has to be also included. They are considered as good as final goods only. You cannot say they are not actually consumed by the final users and then I will exclude it because of that. That would be wrong logic. It should be included. Capital goods also should be included in computation of GDP. In our same example, the farmers using seeds, fertilizers, pesticides, those are intermediate consumption. Those are not final goods. Whatever the value of those goods which are produced in the form of pesticides or insecticides or fertilizers or seeds, will they be added to the value of GDP? No, they will not be. So when the final product of market value of the agricultural produce that happened throughout the country in a particular period is taken, from that the intermediate consumption including the value of seeds, fertilizers, insecticides, pesticides has to be deducted. They become intermediate goods. Tractors cannot be deducted. That is a capital good. That is not an intermediate good. Its value should not be excluded from the computation of GDP. It should be included. Same way, inventory investment, whether positive or negative, should be included in GDP. Very important point to note. In addition to the core definition of GDP, as we have discussed earlier just now. Now, the point also comes, what are the things to be excluded from GDP? conceptually we should know them, and this can be a question also. Of course, intermediate consumption has to be excluded. This should not be there, intermediate consumption. Transfer payments should be excluded. Transfer payments means whatever the government spends in general in the form of welfare payments to the public. Let us say the pensions that the government gives to old people. And in some countries, some unemployment allowance is called as transfer payments. In other words, there is a money flow coming from government to the public, but there is no value addition actually. Popularly, the people are some, I would say, pseudo-economists, call them freebies. Freebies is what the word they use. And some people will be crying, oh, government is spending too much on freebies. So we'll come to that portion of government expenditure and fiscal policy in the chapter 2. But at this point, what we should understand is they should not be included in GDP. They did not add any value, so they should not be included in GDP. So transfer payment should be excluded. Financial transactions should be excluded. Naturally, one person gave 2 lakhs rupees to another person. Is it adding any value to the world? Nothing it is adding. So that should be excluded. Financial transactions should be excluded. Not the fees that is collected in the financial transactions. Let us say bank has charged 100 rupees as a transfer charge in the same transaction we are talking about. That 100 rupees is added value to the GDP because it is a service that has been provided by the bank, and that is the value of that service, 100 rupees. That will be added to GDP, but not the 2 lakhs transaction because it just changed hands. Nothing value added in financial transactions. Same way, somebody purchased some shares in the stock market. Great job he has done. Will that value be added to GDP? No, definitely not. Just changing hands, goods changing, financial instruments particularly, changing hands is not going to be added to the GDP. We have to understand that. Changing hands is not our objective here. Value addition is the objective. Even that is why, if you look at the logic wise, the second hand goods sales also should not be included in GDP because they are just said changing hands. Cars24.com, OLX, etc. A lot of second hand goods are being exchanged by one person to another person. So is all these transactions are going to be included in GDP? No, they will not be. Why? Because no value addition happened, only just changing hands. Of course, again, in the transaction, in the process, if OLX or Cars24 or any other broker or agent has earned some commission in this process, that will be added to GDP because that is something which has actually been done during the previous year in the form of a service, not the changing hands of any goods, including financial transactions. Illegal transactions, how can we include them? Because we don't know. If we know them, then those transactions will stop them. So illegal transactions, if they are happening, smuggling, drugs, etc., gambling, illegal gambling, all these things, whatever happens, we don't know them. We don't know whether they're happening. I mean, we means the government should not, if they're happening, the government should not have let them happen, actually. So government cannot say, I know them, but I will not include, not like that. It is not possible to know them. That is why we cannot include those values. They will not be included. Popularly, these are all called bads. So in economic terms, just for general understanding, so there are two things. One is bads and other one is goods. Goods, you can understand from two ways. Goods and services, goods, good, G-O-D, good, nice, that goods. So bads and goods, this is the general classification. So in GDP, goods will be included, bads will not be included. Illegal transactions cannot be included. And income earned by non-residents is not included in GDP because we are talking at domestic. Domestic means within the territory. Our Indians are working throughout the world. Oh, so many people are working in many countries, America, Australia, Canada, Europe, Gulf, etc. All those people are earning money in those countries. Will that be included to our GDP? Answer is no, because we are talking about domestic territory. Whatever the value addition happened, production of goods or services happened within our country, within our domestic territory of India, whatever is there, that only will be included in GDP. So the income earned by the non-residents will not be included in GDP. That will be excluded. Capital gains, once again, will not be included because there is no value addition. One property is there, it is sold to another person. What value addition happened in that? Nothing happened in that. But again, on the other side, in doing so, some brokerage is paid to a broker. Then that has some service rendered, that will be added. So general profits or losses which are made by selling the existing assets, whether they are capital assets or not, they will not be included in computation of GDP. Second-hand goods, no, they will not be included in GDP. Windfall gains like lottery and all, suddenly somebody has won a lottery, that will not be included in GDP. Why? Because that is not adding value once again. So there is no new thing that has come into existence into the world. Either there should be a good or a service that has actually been produced or rendered during the period, then only it will be added to GDP. Changing hands is not going to be valid. And even though the production actually happened outside India, done by our Indians only, still it will not be added, because GDP, when we say domestic, includes only our domestic territory. That is GDP, gross domestic product. From which angle? Production angle, value added angle. And domestic means only the domestic territory within India, including foreign companies doing some things within India also. So it is a geographical point when you use the word domestic. Domestic is not a national point, it is a geographical point. Whatever happens within the boundaries of India, that comes under the domestic territory of India. So that forms part of GDP of India. Income earned by non-resident Indians will not form part of GDP of India. These are the points to be noted while computing the GDP, that is gross domestic product, naturally at market prices. Now there is a deviation here, a small deviation, important concept and definite possibility of being asked as a question will be always there. What is the difference between a nominal GDP and a real GDP? So GDP, we say, okay, fine, market prices, fine. But at market prices means which market prices? Market price, current market prices, or at constant market prices? If it is at current market prices, which is normally the case, that will be called as nominal GDP. For example, in the year 2017-18, the market value of all the goods and services produced during that period within India is so much, if somebody is saying that. That is at the prices prevailed in that year. At the year of 2017-18 as an example. So whatever the prices prevailed in that year, at that prices those are expressed. But are they comparable to the prices that are prevailing in, let us say, 2019-20? Answer is no. Why? Because there is something called as inflation. The value of money will not be same throughout the years. So what happens then? How can we compare them? How can we compare the GDP of 2017-18 with the GDP of 2019-20? Keeping the external and shocks apart. Shock factors like Corona came almost at the end of the financial year 2020. So forget about that. 17-18 and 19-20 financial years GDP cannot be compared unless we bring both of them to one common ground. If we do that, that is called real GDP. Otherwise, normally 17-18 GDP is nominal GDP. 19-20 GDP is also nominal GDP, which is related to the prices prevailing in that year. Those are current prices. Now, constant prices means all these years' GDPs are restated taking a base year. So, in the case of real GDP, there is always a base year. Base year will be there. Whatever that base year may be, that government will decide. Taking that base year, 2017-18 GDP also will be restated using that base year's inflation. And then 2019-20's GDP also will be restated using that base year's index. And then they become comparable. So real GDP is only for comparison purposes. It is not what is expressed. We have to keep that in mind. Real GDP is only for comparison purposes. It is only for expression. It is not that something which is computed directly. When we compute GDP, we compute nominal GDP only. That is unadjusted GDP only. It has to be adjusted for inflation so that we get real GDP, so that it can be compared among and across different years. That is what is the difference between nominal GDP and real GDP. Let us understand that in the technical words and definitions of these two things. What is nominal GDP or unadjusted GDP? was, as we already discussed, that is nominal GDP, that is the market value of all the final goods produced in a country. That market value depends upon what? The quantities of the goods and services produced and their respective prices, naturally. How do you know the market value of all the goods and services produced in the country? How much quantity produced multiplied with the respective prices prevailing in that year. So, if at all, imagine there is a price change from one period to the next, but the actual output did not change. Output is same, imagine. Then nominal GDP will change or not? Yes, it will change. That means what? Without actually adding any additional output also, just because the price has changed, the nominal GDP is also changing, even though the output has remained constant. Just taking an example, let us say in 1 year, India has produced 10 lakhs tons of cement. Let us say, for example, and its value is whatever it is, let us say some 1 lakh crores rupees, whatever. Just for example, at a price. So if 1 lakh crores rupees is the price, 1 lakh crores rupees is the price we are talking, and 10 lakhs tons of cement is produced, or for convenience purposes, how much will be the price per ton? That will be 10,000 rupees per ton, let us say, only for just convenience purposes. So 10,000 rupees is the price of cement per ton in 1 year. Actually, what happened is in the next year, same 10 lakh tons of sugar cement is produced, next year also. But the price of the cement has increased from 10,000 per ton to, say, 11,000 per ton. So then naturally what happened? This becomes 1.1 lakh crores. So now this year's nominal GDP will have 1.1 lakhs crores of contribution from cement, as an example. So the point is, the production has not changed. No additional great thing happened, but still, just because of a price change, there is a addition to the nominal GDP. Looks like there is a 10% growth. Looks like. But is the growth real? No. That is only a nominal growth. The real growth did not happen. Why this nominal growth happened? Only because of changes in prices. That has to be kept in mind. Okay. Now, coming to the real GDP here, that will be same. It should not change. The price is not the matter here. What is the real actual production added during the year will matter in case of real GDP. So, real GDP, let us say, accounts for price changes that may have occurred due to inflation. Accounts for means it deflates actually. In other words, real GDP is nothing but nominal GDP adjusted for inflation. So, nominal GDP is 1.1 lakh crores in our example. If you deflate it, it comes back to 1 lakh crores only. That is adjusted for inflation. If prices change from one period to the next, but actual output does not change, then the real GDP will remain the same. Only price changed in our example, actual output did not change. What happens to nominal GDP? It will change. What happens to real GDP? It will not change. It will remain the same. So what happens is, basically the real GDP reflects the changes in real production. Real production actually happened. That only will be reflected by real GDP, because it will adjust the nominal GDP for inflation. So, changes in the nominal GDP due to the changes in the price should be excluded so that the real GDP can be calculated and presented. So, imagine if there is no inflation or deflation. Imagine that situation will not be there. In that case, nominal GDP will be same as that of real GDP. Both will be same if there is no inflation or deflation. So, that is a point to be noted. Nominal GDP and real GDP. Don't worry about the numbers and all. As an example, whatever we take, that is not the purpose of computations here. When we look at them, we have to understand what is the resultant of that. So, practically, whatever the numbers that we take for our understanding purposes, they need not be looked at seriously. There may be computational mistakes in that. That doesn't matter. The concept has to be understood very clearly. Nominal GDP is that which is shown and presented at current market prices. Real GDP is that which is shown and presented at constant prices without considering the inflation, or without including the inflation, or we can say deflating the nominal GDP, we will get real GDP. Simply speaking, real GDP is nothing but nominal GDP divided by deflator. That's what is real GDP formula. That's it. That is about nominal GDP and real GDP. So GDP at current prices is nominal GDP, GDP at constant prices is real GDP. Either way, the questions can be asked. This is only for understanding purposes how the nominal GDP and real GDP of India has been there since long time, only for general understanding. And you can look at the differences between the nominal GDP and real GDP also is not constant. The inflation itself is not constant. The difference between the nominal and real GDP is inflation. So that inflation itself is changing. And naturally, the nominal GDP or normal GDP is higher than real GDP all the times. So our GDP growth rates, when we said we had too much of growth rates in percentage terms, double digit growth rates, those are all different. Those are all looking at nominal GDP, but the real GDP is much lesser than that. And as you can see in the recent past, the real GDP also has come down mostly from this point onwards, from 2016-17 onwards. From 17-18, again it came down, again it came down, again it came down. So that is the real GDP which we should look at for the actual trends and tendencies. Nominal GDP might be giving us altogether a different picture. Not always it will give the same picture. But also the point has to be noted here, the data up to 2011-12 are based on the 4-5 GDP series. That is a base year for the data up to 2011-12, up to this period, the base year was different. Up to this period, later on, the base year has changed to 11-12 series. So base year is changed to 11-12, and from there onwards, 11-12 has become the base year, and from 12-13 onwards, that the deflator is based on 2011-12's inflation. So the base year will be periodically checked and changed by the government also. That is one more thing because of which the data may not be comparable all the times. For example, if you have to compare the data, we cannot compare the 2004-05 data with the 2017-18 data directly here. Why? Because base year taken for 2004-05 growth rates computation and 2017-18 growth rates computation is not the same. So when the base year is same, then the comparability will be better. When the base year changes, naturally the comparability of past data with the current data will become difficult. But yes, once 2012-13 onwards, whatever the base year is used, which is 2011-12, all those things will be definitely comparable, no doubt in that. That is the general practical observation of nominal GDP growth rate and real GDP growth rate. We are not talking about nominal GDP and real GDP computation only. We are looking at the growth rates here of India as published in Indian Express. And recently there was another news also in the Economic Times which says the base year for GDP will be again changed. Already it was changed from 2004-05 to 2011-12. Now 2011-12 is going to be changed once again, is what the news has come somewhere in November of 2019. And what will be the base year, that is not yet decided, but that will probably change the existing base year of 2011-12 is the essence of this news. So the ministry is working to bring a new series of national accounts which would result in a change in the existing base year of 2011-12, and that is the Ministry of Statistics and Program Implementation that will be responsible for deciding all these base years. And they wanted to change the base year once again. And what is that base year that we have to look at? So far, there is nothing new update on this, because right from the beginning of almost 2020, the country has been busy with some other things. So right now there is no change. But one point here to note also is, the fact is, the economic growth slowed towards the 6 years low of 5% in the April-June period of this fiscal. Already, this was pre-corona, already the economic growth rate was down. But once again, these are all just facts. These are just something which are there in the public domain, which are related to the economy as data, as information. Only they have to be used for understanding what concepts we already have known. Only for that purpose. They will not be useful for any other examination purpose. Only for substantiating what we already know, they can be used. So that is about the GDP concept, the gross domestic product concept. With that, we can conclude the discussion on GDP particularly. And we discussed about GDP at market prices to start with. And there will be so many other different variants of such computation, gross and net difference, as we observed already, that is depreciation, and domestic and national difference that we'll come to know. Also, market prices and factor cost expressions of various economic aggregates. We'll discuss these things in the next session, but the observation and understanding of those items will greatly depend upon the understanding of the basic concepts of national income that we have discussed in current session. So I hope you all have understood well, and you have to read these things also carefully and write the key points in your own notes, in your own handwriting, so that these concepts are applied in the questions if they are asked in the examination. And they will be also possible to be asked in the form of problems. And while solving those problems, blindly by hearting the formula and solving them is one type of approach, which I don't suggest. If you understand the concepts of them, what are the things to be included, what are the things not to be included in the computation of GDP, those will be very helpful. And then the problem solving also becomes relatively easier. When the understanding is the easiest point, then by hearting need not be done. When the understanding has happened relatively easily, that is enough for the application of those concepts in the examination questions. We'll continue this discussion in the next session. Till then, take care. Bye-bye. Thank you very much.